kpfa.org. It's time for Pushing Limits.
Good afternoon. This is Eddie Ytuarte here on Pushing Limits, disability-oriented radio on KPFA in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. And it's a really nice, great day, kind of still. So I like this weather, and I hope you folks like this program we're going to have today. And we're going to be talking about housing issues and problems affecting rental housing, especially those things that affect tenants with disabilities. In the last few years, perhaps the most publicized rental issue has to do with what's called foreclosures. Disabled tenants often have received notices that the owners of the property have not been able to pay a loan or mortgage, and they have to give up the rights to the property to a financial institution, and often the bank. So where does this leave tenants? The notice itself can create a lot of anxiety, especially if the tenant with a disability is low income and does not have the income to find another unit. But are people really threatened if they get foreclosures, or worse? What if they get an eviction notice as a result of the foreclosure? To talk about this, we're going to have attorney Brendan Darrow, who is an Equal Justice Works Fellow at the East Bay Community Law Center in Berkeley. And then we also will be talking about other legal issues affect tenants and people with disabilities. But before that, we're going to speak briefly to Grecia Lima with Mujeres Unidas, or Women United, who's going to give us a brief update on the Domestic Workers Bill of Rights. That's the state legislation aimed at raising the economic welfare of our valuable home care workers. We last spoke to Grecia in August of 2011. So hi, Grecia.
Hi, Eddie. Thank you so much for having me here.
Oh, you're quite welcome. So, Grecia, please remind us, or just summarize what this Domestic Bill of Rights bill is.
Yeah, so the California Domestic Workers Bill of Rights, what it's trying to do is to include the about 200,000 domestic workers into the already existing labor protections that most other workers have. Things like overtime, mealtime, and rest break. And this comes from an outdated exclusion of domestic workers in the 1930s because they were not being valued as real workers. We know that the law has changed and times have changed, but the protections for domestic workers have not. So what we're trying to do is not extend new regulations, but give the same basic labor protections that all other workers have to this vital and important industry in our time. And you're right. Last time that we spoke, it was August of 2011, uh-huh. And we have been working really hard to try to make some changes to our bill. And we, you know, we think we're really hopeful and we're really close into building in some flexibility that won't affect especially people with disabilities that are very, very low income.
Okay. Now, it passed the Assembly, right?
Yes. Passed the Assembly. It passed the Senate Labor, and it's now in the Senate Appropriations Committee.
Uh-huh.
So basically, on the Senate Appropriations Committee, usually bills are heard on August.
Okay.
We're thinking that we probably will be ready prior to August. But, you know, that's kind of the usual timeline of the bills. And then after Senate Appropriations Committee, you go into the Senate floor vote. And after the Senate floor vote, you go back to the Assembly just for an up or down vote. And then you get sent to the governor's desk. So that's kind of the last steps that we need for our bill to become the law.
Now, since August when we spoke, has there been any changes?
I think that there has been the changes that we have happened have been more internal conversations with the opposition that we care about, which is the disability rights organizations. And since August, we have had continuous conversations as to what are some things that we can do to create flexibility on the bill for people that need this care while at the same time still still protecting workers. So we are working on building in flexibility. We think we're really close to finding those out-of-the-box solutions that are going to still protect workers and build in flexibility for individual families.
Yeah, okay. So you folks are working with the disability organizations. So last time I checked, they're still pretty much the ones that were opposed at that as of last year are still opposed to it. Also, the big-time home care industry, the profits, there's still another major sector that are opposed to it. I guess you necessarily haven't been able to speak to them, right?
We have been speaking to them, and we have conversations, several conversations with them, and I think that we, on our part, also are building in that flexibility and trying to look at other scenarios and other industries so that we can see what other industries are doing to kind of bring forward solutions for this vital industry. And since the last time we spoke, we have had several working sessions with the disability rights oppositions. And just this Monday, we were also on another radio show, and Tom Amiano said that, we're really hopeful that we're going to be coming forward really soon with a solution that is going to work for most people. But I think that what is important is that we both need to come in with the intent and commitment that we're going to build flexibility while at the same time still protecting workers that are vulnerable in this industry.
Okay, Grecia, thanks a lot for talking to us.
Thank you so much for having me.
And we should be following up and continue to see how the progress of this bill is going.
Sounds great. Thank you so much, Grecia.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we have Brendan Darrow. And he's the, once again, he's an attorney at the Equal Justice Works Fellow at the East Bay Community Law Center in Berkeley. Thanks for coming in, Brendan.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, so you're at the East Bay Community Law Center, and briefly, just explain, just tell us a little bit about that fine institution. I think it's a fine institution.
Thank you very much. Well, the East Bay Community Law Center is a free legal services provider. We're located in Berkeley, but we're actually the largest free legal services provider to tenants in, or to, excuse me, clients in Alameda County. So people from all over the county can get assistance with a number of different legal issues. Now, I'm in the housing unit, and so I assist renters in Berkeley, Oakland, Emeryville, and the city of Alameda. And we do we provide them with a range of services and in terms of tenants' rights, also eviction defense, assistance with subsidized housing. And my specific project is working with renters in foreclosed properties. So I have an Equal Justice Works Fellowship that's funded by the Pillsbury Winthrop Shaw Pittman Foundation. And that enables me to work directly with renters who are in foreclosed properties and assist them with all the unique challenges that they face.
Okay, so let's talk about foreclosures. So tenants get, first thing they do, tenants might get a letter just from their landlords or somebody else advising that their home that they're renting might be foreclosed. Is that something of concern to people?
Well, it's pretty frightening if you're the tenant and, you just paid your rent for March, say, and you get this letter that says, your landlord's going to lose the property, or your landlord comes and tells you, I'm going to lose the property, or somebody else comes and knocks on the door and says your landlord already lost the property. This is a situation where things can get very confusing for the tenant. And the important thing for tenants to know is that they have rights even after a foreclosure. Wherever you are in the country, you have rights as a tenant after a foreclosure. So the important thing is to find out what those rights are and the way in which your local protections might be even stronger than the rights you have nationally.
Okay, let's go by level then. Are there any federal protections against foreclosures with a tenant with disability, other than maybe some notices of 60 days or what?
There is actually a law specifically directed at tenants who are in foreclosed properties on the federal level. It's called the Protecting Tenants at Foreclosure Act. And this law applies to all tenants in properties that have been lost at foreclosure. And it lays out specific ground rules for the new owner, the foreclosing bank, so to speak, or an investor that purchases the property in a short sale or under some other circumstances. What it says is that the successor, the new owner, has to honor the lease of the tenant through the expiration of that lease, or if that lease expires within 90 days or if it's month to month, the successor, the new owner, has to give at least 90 days notice before evicting the tenant. So that's for everybody in the United States. And it's important to know that there are certain carve-outs, there's certain ways in which it might not apply to you, but you really need to look at the law and talk with an attorney about that issue.
Okay. Now, at the state level, are there any protections, any added protections other than what you've told us?
Not anything stronger than the federal law at the state level. So if you're in Fresno, the strongest protection that you have will still be that federal law.
Okay. How about just cause? What if you're in Oakland?
If you're in Oakland or Berkeley or San Francisco, there are actually many cities across the state of California that have some form of what's called just cause protection, then you have stronger protections than you do in other cities. And so if, let's say, for example, you live in Berkeley, well, you're protected by the Berkeley Rent Stabilization and Good Cause for Eviction Ordinance. And that gives you all sorts of additional rights. It protects you from an increase in the rent in excess of what's called the annual general adjustment. You can talk with the Berkeley Rent Board about that. It also protects you from being evicted for reasons other than the specific reasons laid out in the law that are considered the good causes. And the good news here, when we're talking about foreclosures, is that foreclosure is not a good cause for eviction.
And I think a lot of tenants don't really understand it or don't know the law, so it's really helpful for those of us who know a little bit about it to be able to spread the word and tell people there is just cause in San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley, and other communities. And I think, I don't know if the landlords play dumb, you know, but they send out notices if they're in Oakland, and they're not saying that, they're saying just because you get foreclosed that you got to go out and keeping people in the dark that there is these protective laws. So a lot of it, I think, is just a battle of education and getting word out. Related to that, and with all these different levels, do people with disabilities have any kind of extra protections because of the disability, other than say maybe some local just cause laws?
Well, people with disabilities have the same additional protections in the situation of being in a foreclosure as they do in any other tenancy, in that they're entitled to a reasonable accommodation for those disabilities, and they're protected from discrimination on the basis of the disability. There's one other additional protection federally that's important, which is that Section 8 tenants, if you're a Section 8 tenant in a foreclosed property, the foreclosing bank or investor or whomever is required to participate in the Section 8 program. And that, you know, some disabled people are lucky enough to be on, have access to the Section 8 program and have a Section 8 voucher, in which case that would help them. But that's the main additional protection that exists.
Mm-hmm. Now, in the state of California, if there's somebody, this is not necessarily related to foreclosure, but in the state of California, if somebody is on the Section 8 program and the owner could terminate the contract with a local housing authority, as I understand, but then they are their rents limited, controlled for a while, or what?
So what happens with an owner termination of a contract for Section 8, it's important first for our listeners to understand that there's actually two contracts in a Section 8 arrangement. Section 8 is a voucher program where a tenant is able to get a voucher from the local housing authority that enables them to go and rent a property from a landlord and only pay a portion of the rent, and then the housing authority will pay the other portion. So the termination, the contract that the landlord is able to terminate is the contract with the housing authority for the additional income, and they're able to terminate it for good cause but the good cause is limited, and you really need to look specifically at the regulations published by the Housing and Urban Development and also the local housing authority to see whether or not what the landlord's doing qualifies as good cause. Unfortunately, sometimes landlords use the term other economic reason as a good cause, which is pretty expansive. So that can be tricky.
Yeah. Let's turn to other things other than the foreclosures, which I think we've covered pretty good. What's rent regulation or rent control?
So the idea of rent control is to ensure that as the housing market fluctuates, it doesn't make it impossible for people with modest income to hang on to their housing. So if you're living in an apartment in Berkeley and the market rent in Berkeley is going up by 10% a year, well, that might become unaffordable rather quickly for you. So what rent control does is it ensures that once you've started renting an apartment, the apartment's rent will only increase by a reasonably stable and predictable amount each year. And that amount will be determined by the Rent Stabilization Board here in Berkeley or by the Oakland Residential Rent Adjustment Program in Oakland, or each city, you go city by city and they have different programs. So they determine that, the proper rate that the rent should go up should be something closer to what the real inflation is. So in Berkeley, they call it the annual general adjustment, and they determine it based on a number of factors. But the idea is to try to keep it reasonable so that people can hang on to their housing and everybody doesn't get forced out by the, spikes and troughs of the housing market.
Okay, now rent control is a function of city or municipal ordinances, so it's up to the city to be able to pass if they want to, some form of rent control, rent regulation. It's not something necessarily that comes from the state.
That's right. In fact, there have been legislative efforts on the state level to undermine rent control. The most important one of those is called Costa-Hawkins, and it had many effects, but one of them was that no single-family home in the state of California is allowed to be rent-controlled. And so if you rent a single-family home, your home is unfortunately exempt from the protections of rent control, regardless of what city you live in, because at the state level, people didn't want rent control to be strong enough to protect those particular kinds of homes.
Now, what if a tenant is living in a home built after 1983 and there is no rent control, say, in the community? Would that community be able to impose rent control?
I'm sorry. It sounded like there were sort of two parts of the question. Mm-hmm. Did you suggest that there is no rent control in that community? This is not Berkeley.
Well, I guess I misstated. Could you have rent control in any community for buildings built after 1983 under Costa-Hawkins?
I'm not certain of the answer to that, actually.
Okay.
But I can tell you that most of the ordinances, especially Oakland and Berkeley and San Francisco, have provisions that exempt all new construction from being covered by rent control and eviction control, which is problematic. And, in fact, there are whole sections in each of these ordinances that set forth a number of types of properties that wouldn't be included. One of those types that we commonly see is owner-occupied units. So if you live in a triplex and the owner of the triplex lives next door to you in one of those three units, you may not be protected the same way that you would be if the owner didn't live there. And so with all of these ordinances, you need to consult either with a tenant's rights workshop of some sort or with the ordinance itself and take a look and see if there's an exemption that would apply to your building. One great resource for people who are out there, and maybe not in Berkeley or Oakland, but are wondering whether they're protected, is tenantstogether.org. You can Google Tenants Together. It's easy enough to find them. And they have a wonderful resource for all tenants in California to find out what the protections that they have locally are and what agencies are available to assist those people.
And they are in San Francisco, is that called?
Yeah. That's right. They're based in San Francisco.
Now, what if a person with a disability finds something wrong with their unit, like that, if they're living in a four- or five-story building and the elevator breaks down? what's the first thing that they might want to do in a situation like that? Where do they go? People sometimes don't know where to go for this.
Well, if the issue is that something about the conditions of your unit is impeding your ability to enjoy take advantage of the housing accommodations that you've rented. So if you're living in a fourth floor apartment, but you can't use the stairs because of your disability and the elevator goes out, well, that's an example of something that needs to be repaired immediately in order for you to maintain access to your apartment. And so if you're a disabled tenant and that happens to you, you should immediately contact your landlord and tell them, in case you didn't know, I'm disabled. I'm unable to access my apartment except by this elevator. So I need a reasonable accommodation, basically starting now, to make sure that I'm able to get up into my apartment and down out of my apartment. You need to repair the elevator, and if it's going to take a long time to repair the elevator, we need to come up with an alternative method for me to get into my apartment. In that situation, it may be impossible to get to the apartment without fixing the elevator, in which case they need to get on it immediately. And it's all the more reason why the tenant should not hesitate to contact the landlord and tell them about the problem, because the landlord's not obligated to make what's called a reasonable accommodation unless they're aware of the necessity for the reasonable accommodation.
Okay, and then if the landlord still doesn't want to do it, can't they go to some cities? Don't some cities have inspection, building inspection departments that come out and inspect problems like this?
That's true. There are usually city level, you could call them municipal code enforcement departments. Really what you're talking about is a housing inspector, somebody who comes out and makes sure that the property is up to code, so to speak. And that may mean a lot of different things. That may mean making sure that everything was built with permits. It may also mean making sure that everything has been kept up to date, and kept in working order. When it comes to an elevator, that's certainly something that a code inspector would cite them for if it's broken. But there are other things like the necessity for, say, grab bars in a shower that wouldn't constitute a codes violation per se. You wouldn't know that it was a violation just because there's no bars in the shower to hold on to. That might be something that a tenant needs as a reasonable accommodation, but that a code enforcement officer would not cite the landlord for.
Would that kind of accommodation be provided for through the Americans with Disability Act, or is that act that specific to mandate something like this, allowing tenants to have grab bars in bathrooms?
Well, there's actually three different, very similar laws that have to do with this sort of situation. There's the Americans with Disabilities Act, which you mentioned. There's also the Fair Employment and Housing Act, which is a state law that is the most specific with regard to forcing the landlord to provide these reasonable accommodations to tenants in their housing. And then there's also the Fair Housing Act, which is a federal law that's similar as well and applies across the country. Now, these acts all set forth the idea that a tenant is entitled to reasonable accommodations for their disability, which means that if there's something that's necessary, whether it's a policy or a structural change, that's necessary to ensure that they have equal access, then the landlord is required to do it. And there are some circumstances in which the thing that is requested is so expensive that it would be considered an undue burden to the landlord. And in those circumstances, the landlord's still required to let it happen, but the tenant may have to pay for it. And that's really, a case-by-case question.
Yeah, the tenant pays for it, and then when they move out, say it's a ramp or something, I think they have to take it down.
Right, they may have to restore the condition of the property to what it was when the tenant moved in.
And there are some disability organizations, I could think of anyway, the Center for Independent Living, that will assist people, tenants with disabilities, to make some modifications in their home. So there are some few resources in case any disabled tenants need that they might want to look around. Let's go to another issue that it seems often of people are complaining about, and that's the issue of mold. Do you have any idea what if there's any resources where people can go to have a mold issue looked at or rectified?
Mold is a very difficult problem to solve here in California, and especially in the Bay Area, because there are literally millions of types of mold, and some of them can be very bad for your health. However, because there are so many different kinds of mold, it can be difficult to establish whether the type of mold that's in your home is harming your health or whether there's some other thing that's harming your health instead. And so it becomes a very difficult legal battle when it comes to trying to make sure you can draw a clear line between an illness that you're suffering as a result of mold and the mold in your home actually causing that illness. So I want to say that up front, because it's a question that a lot of lawyers will say, you know, oh, that's too difficult to answer, it's very complicated. Really what it comes down to is science, and what can be very expensive is testing the mold and establishing that it's a type of mold that is dangerous to your health. Now, there are some cities in California which are enacting laws and regulations helping to have these code enforcement inspectors we mentioned earlier to try to combat mold. But it's the beginning of a long fight right now in California. We're only just starting to address this problem. It's a public health concern that we should all be aware of, but one where the remedies are really just getting off the ground.
Yeah, because in Oakland, the city inspectors don't inspect for mold, but they might inspect for conditions leading to the mold, like leaks or something. So they might actually tell the owner, well, fix the leak, but they don't even test for the mold. So that continues to be a major problem. Another major problem in this state, anyhow, is security deposits. And people often complain to me, I'm at the Oakland Tenants Union, of people not getting back their security deposits from the landlord, and or else some of it's been deducted illegally. You know, what about this?
Unfortunately, there are some landlords who choose to systematically steal security deposits from their tenants, or to systematically use the tenants' security deposits to sort of renovate or improve the apartments after the tenants leave. And that is illegal in California, and it's very clear that it's illegal. The security deposit statute is a state law that very specifically lays out all of the guidelines for the return of a security deposit. And one of the things it says, unquestionably, is that a landlord may only make deductions from the security deposit to cover damage exceeding ordinary wear and tear. So that's anything that you did to the property that wasn't a normal consequence of living there. If you put thumbtack holes in a wall because you're decorating the apartment, that is not exceeding ordinary wear and tear. If the carpet wears out because you've lived there for 15 years, the carpet's not designed to last forever. So the landlord replacing the carpet after you moved out is not ordinary wear and tear, and they're taking your deposit and using it illegally. There is one other thing, however, that the landlord is allowed to deduct from your deposit, and that's unpaid rent. And so when there's a dispute between a landlord and a tenant that gets ugly, sometimes the tenant will leave without giving a lot of notice, and then the landlord will choose to bill the tenant for the time, the remainder of a month or the following month, and say, I didn't get enough notice, so I'm billing you. Theoretically, that could be okay if the landlord did what's called attempt to mitigate his damages. He's supposed to try to re-rent the apartment. And, of course, if he re-rents the apartment during that time, he can't charge you rent and the new tenant rent.
Okay. Thanks a lot for the great information. This time's really gone fast. We've been talking to Brendan Darrow, who is an attorney and an equal a Justice Works Fellow at the East Bay Community Law Center. Can you give us contact information for EBCLC?
Yes. So the East Bay Community Law Center, like KPFA, is a community made possible by the support of the community. We're here for the community.
What's phone number?
And our phone number is 510-548-4040.
Thanks a lot to Engineer Joe Montgomery and Josh Atwood from Pushing Limits. Don't make sense not to keep on pushing.
Hello, KPFA listener supporters. thanks to all who contributed to KPFA. This is what keeps us all going strong. From phone room volunteers and food donors to listeners who pledge their support, all of you ensure the longevity and effectiveness of KPFA. We can't do it without you. There are many, many ways to support and stay connected to KPFA. First, and most importantly, we ask everyone to promote and recommend KPFA to family and friends. You may also donate securely online at kpfa.org. And you can look us up on YouTube, MySpace, Flickr, Facebook, and Twitter. You can even send snail mail to 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way, Berkeley, California, 94704. Please continue to support your free speech community radio station.